Today, the sermon is based on our theme, Come Holy Spirit, and the topic is Made Adventurous. You have to remind me not to mix coffee, which has caffeine, with cough mixture that has codeine. I took both last night and I'm like floating at the moment. So if I fall asleep halfway through, Preacher Wendy will come up and preach. Let's just pray. Lord, would you just open our hearts and minds that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. In the name of Christ, amen. We've covered several topics in this series of Come Holy Spirit, and we've said when the Spirit comes, we will be made sure, we will be made alive, we will be made clear, useful, holy, and so on. But we also looked at the topic of being made bold when the Holy Spirit comes. And today we are looking at being made adventurous. So what's the difference between being made bold and made adventurous? Well, adventurous means where we are more daring. Okay, bold, you're still within the norms and traditions, you're still within the box, but you are bold. Daring is one step further. Just to give you an example, if you talk about being bold, it's getting into a boat when there's a big storm. But you will still stay in the boat when you're bold. But when you want to be adventurous, you actually step out of the boat. I don't have a picture of raging storm here, but it's stepping out of the boat and walking on water during the storm. In other words, in Hokkien, we say siao. Okay, so we are talking about boldness. It's a kind of Don Quixote de la Mancha kind of picture, where we look for risks, we take on risks with eyes open, we move out of comfort zones and break out of the box. It's the do the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear the unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go. Or those of you who are Star Trek people, okay, it's to boldly go where no man has gone before. And that's the kind of adventure spirit that the Lord gives us when the Holy Spirit comes on us. So Holy Spirit, when he comes, we become adventurous, daring, risk-taking, move out of normal boundaries. Now, if we look at the scriptures, we find that in Matthew chapter 28, Jesus said to his disciples, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations." All the nations. Then we have, when Jesus ascended, he says, "Wait, because the Holy Spirit will come upon you," and it did on the day of Pentecost. The disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit. And Peter preached a sermon, a lot of people became Christians, new converts, thousands of them came in, but did they go out and preach to all nations? Not exactly, they stayed in Jerusalem. Because to them it's enough already, you've got two groups of Jews. You've got the Hebraic Jews, like the Chinese who speak Chinese, and then you've got the Greek-orientated Jews who are like the Chinese who speak English only, the Amokantang type, you know, who don't really understand Mandarin or don't read Mandarin like me. I don't read Mandarin. I flunked my Mandarin. So you've got this two, which means that you've got two groups with different cultures. And it's already hard enough for them to try to make disciples of 3,000 people. So they had to appoint a group of people to reach out to the people who were Greek-orientated Jews to make sure that they are not left out, so they appointed deacons to take care of them. You read that in Acts 6. So they were doing enough already, but they were not exactly going into the world, into the nations, as it were. Of course, the Holy Spirit did get them to do a few things that were different. One of the deacons appointed, Philip, was led by the Holy Spirit to reach out to the Ethiopian eunuch in a very miraculous way you can read in Acts 8. Then the Apostle Peter was told in a sort of trance vision that he was supposed to reach out to this guy who was coming to him, this Roman soldier, Cornelius. So this is in Acts 10. So there were little exceptions where they were going out of their comfort zones to reach out to non-Jews. But generally, if you look at the disciples of Jesus, they were not very adventurous types. Neither were the followers of Jesus, the bigger group of people. Mostly they were reaching out to the Jews. You've got fishermen, one ex-civil servant, and a few others. You look at all these professions, they're not exactly the sort that will go outside the box. Were they bold? Yeah, they were bold. They were bold enough to do things that were frightening. Like Ananias, if you read about him in Acts 9, he heard about this great persecutor of the Christians named Saul. Later on, Saul became Paul. But he was frightened when the Lord says, go and pray for this guy. But he went, he prayed for Saul, who became Paul, the apostle. So he took the risk. Yes, he was bold. Then we've got people who became Christians despite their standing in society. They could lose their standing in society, but they risked it. They became bold enough to do it, like somebody called Damaris, this lady who was probably from high social status. You can read in Acts 17. Or Erastus of Corinth, who was a director of public works. So he was the minister of, you know, the public works, like PWD in the past. I don't know what they call them now. But he became a Christian. So he was bold enough to take that step. But were they adventurous? You remember? Adventurous is a bit siao, kind of going beyond the normal. Not really. You see, Pentecost was inspiration for them in a sense. It was an experience. But that wasn't enough to push them out. Sometimes Christians need to be pushed to move out. And there were two things that happened to push them out, the apostles and the disciples of Jesus. First, there was persecution. After Stephen was martyred, it says in Acts 8, they were all scattered because there was this big persecution. They were all scattered around the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. The apostles still stayed in Jerusalem. The second thing that happened was in AD 70 when the Jews rebelled against the Romans and the Romans came in, destroyed the temple, destroyed Jerusalem, and all the Jews, including Jewish Christians, were expelled from Jerusalem. So they were pushed out. The disciples of Jesus moved out. And you see how far they moved. They went to Spain. James went to Spain. Ethiopia in Africa. Matthew went there. In Europe, several of them went to very far parts of Europe. And then you've got India. Thomas went to India. So they started spreading out. It was only after the Lord pushed them, then they moved. Some of us might need to be pushed to move beyond our safe boundaries. Then you've got Apostle Paul. You think, Apostle Paul, what, this guy, not bad, he went everywhere. But if you look at his story, he had this encounter with the risen Christ at Damascus Road. But his background was, he was a scholar. It's the sort that you think will stay in Trinity Theological College, you know, debates, theology, books, stuff like that, unless he's like Indiana Jones or Indiana Jones' father, then he might go out and do something. But you don't see Paul, you know, that kind of adventurous. So he started actually reaching out to the Jews. But then something happened. In Acts 18, it says that he was with the Jews, he was trying to tell them about Jesus the Christ, but when they opposed and insulted him, he shook out his garments and told them, your blood be on your own heads, I'm innocent of it. From now on, I go to the Gentiles. So there was this push. And Paul went on three different missionary journeys throughout this whole space of place or places and reached out to people and brought them to Christ. So what have we seen so far? When the Holy Spirit comes, he gives us a daring spirit. Although sometimes God's people need that push to move out, inspiration is not enough. Sometimes we sing inspiration, automatically we go, we don't. Sometimes he has to push us. But then sometimes the inspiration isn't enough, his push is not enough for us to take another step, but it's one step at a time. It's not immediate that we will go to do daring things. Look at our founder, the founder of Methodism, John Wesley. He was an Anglican priest, an academic, as it were, from Oxford University. And we know that he had an experience with the Lord on the 24th of May in 1738, what we call the Aldersgate experience. That's how our church got its name. Aldersgate is the name of the street where he had a heartwarming experience with the Lord. But then he also had a Pentecost experience. Remember, the May experience was in 1738. In 1739, on the 1st of January, they were all gathered together in prayer in their society meeting, the Methodist Society meeting in Fetter Lane. At about 3 in the morning, they were there overnight prayer. where we were in instant in prayer, the power of God came mightily upon us, and many cried out with exceeding joy, and many fell to the ground. And that was his Pentecost experience. Well, this was in January. In March, somebody wrote to him. It was from another Anglican priest by the name of Whitfield, George Whitfield, and then also another guy called Mr. Seward. And they were asking him to go to Bristol. And he says, this I was not at all forward to do. He wasn't very keen. Why? Because in Bristol were a group of people like the miners. They were all the people, the low-class people down there. And he wasn't very keen to go out and preach the gospel to them because some of them, like the miners, were considered worse than animals. But also, Anglican priests during his time will only preach in church. They do not go out in the open air to preach. That would be considered very low class. Okay? It's not because it's against the law. Like Singapore, you cannot go out and suddenly preach anywhere, but they can there, but it's considered low class. Okay? And it's not done. Well, that Wednesday, he brought the whole proposal to the Methodist Society in Fetter Lane. Generally, you can read between the lines, the people were not very keen. His own brother was also an Anglican priest, would scarcely bear the mention of it. His brother says, no, don't be crazy, don't do that. Okay, on Saturday the 31st of March, he says he went there to Bristol and met Mr. Whitfield. He could scarcely reconcile himself to preach this way because he says that, he follows decency and order. And he would almost have thought the saving of souls almost a sin if it's not done in the church. Monday, at 4 p.m, I submitted to be more vile and proclaimed in the highways the glad tidings of salvation to 3,000 people. See, one step at a time. Sunday, on the 8th, 7 a.m, I preached to about 1,000 people in Bristol, then 1,500 on the top of Hannon Mount in Kingswood, and then later on, about 5,000. One step at a time. When the Holy Spirit comes, He gives us a spirit of daring. Sometimes we need to be pushed into it. Sometimes it takes one step at a time. I think many of us say, I can't be me, I'm not Peter or Thomas or John Wesley. How can I go? Well, let me ask, how many of you have heard of these people? Tychicus, Aristarchus, and Epaphras. Have you heard of them? Some of you have, huh? I haven't, until I started searching the scriptures. Then I realized that the first guy was one of Paul's companions on his third missionary journey. He was actually the one that Paul sent to do things for him, bring messages here and there. He was the one who brought the letter to the Ephesians. He brought 2 Corinthians, the second letter of Corinthians, to the Corinthians. He was one of the representatives of the Gentile group, the Gentile Christians, and he brought the money to Jerusalem, which meant he was very trustworthy. He was sent to Crete to work with Titus. He was sent to Ephesus to take over from Timothy. He was sent to Colossae, carrying out the instructions of Paul. And he was also with Paul during the imprisonment of Paul. The second guy, Aristarchus, he was arrested along with Paul in Ephesus. Then he followed Paul on his third missionary journey where they had this shipwreck. He also went through it. And he and another guy, after this I'll mention that guy, they took turns becoming voluntary prisoners so that Paul won't be alone. Now, if you talk about daring, this is adventurous. It's going to the risk level already. Then Epaphras, this guy is an intercessor. I didn't realize that, he was an intercessor. And he returned to Colossae, he evangelized, he was an evangelist as well. He reached out to several other places, and he was another prisoner who alternated with the previous guy to be with Paul and supported him in the ministry. Now, these are ordinary people, and God uses ordinary people who dare to step out of the box. How many of you are teachers here or ex-teachers? The joke is in our church, you throw a stone, you hit two teachers. Living Waters Methodist, you throw a stone, you hit five doctors over there. Our church is full of teachers. Well, this lady was a teacher for 20 years. And it's a higher class kind of mission school. So it's a bit like Fairfield, but maybe it's more like MGS, you know, a bit more upper class type. And she became the principal. Very respectable, right? Comfortable. And then she realized that around the school were a lot of kids in the slum area, and they were poor, and there were also lepers, and there were homeless children and youth. So she felt at the age of 30-something that she needs to come out and do this work. So she opened a home for the dying, home for lepers, home for homeless children and youth. She's got a name that I can't pronounce. You know who she is? Mother Teresa. You say, only a teacher. But see what God can use a teacher to do. We always say we are so limited, you know, I'm too young, too old, educated, not educated, single, family also got too many commitments. So we always have some good excuse. Or the cause is not that popular, it's not something that people want to get into. We need Christians who will be able to stand as Christians on the position of the faith and yet reach out in love to the LGBT people and say, how do we show that we love them despite the fact that we say what they are doing is wrong if they are practicing it? Or in certain situations, activism for the people who are unjustly imprisoned or activism for animals or whatever it is. The cause might not be the popular one, but we say, nah, not me. But note, God will always use something that's already built into us. If you look at Paul, his personality, he's very sure of himself. He has Roman citizenship. He was somebody who can make tents to earn his own living. And he's a scholar. He's got knowledge, wisdom, maturity. He was in his 40s when he started moving out. So he was excellent as a missionary, a church planter, and a writer. You look at the disciples of Jesus. Just now we said, they are quite insular. But, you know, they've got something that most Jews didn't have. Most Jews don't like the sea. They were more people of the land. Okay? If you read the book of Revelation, it says, and there will not be any more sea. Because sea represents chaos. Okay? So those of you who love fishing, it doesn't mean no more fish. But it basically says, chaos will be gone. But it means that the Jews' mentality is the sea is not good. But they were fishermen. So what does it mean? It's easy for them to take the ship, go somewhere else to preach the gospel. So God takes that which is within us already. Mother Teresa was a nun for 20 over years. She's got all the spiritual disciplines to support her in dark times. She's got the example of Roman Catholic saints to inspire her, and she's got resources of the church as well. God takes that which we already have. So just look, what has the Lord inbuilt in you? In terms of passion or giftings or language or skills or training, just look at one. Let's say we look at passion. Some of you have passion for the unreached, but it might be a different group that you have. It might be for tribal people, it might be for gamers, Some people just sit whole day, play games. And very few Christians are there to create Christian games. In fact, the Christian games are very boring. And some Christians have started creating something called they call them the paladins who go in and actually preach the gospel in this game world as well. I mean, we need people who are able to move out of the box in areas like that. If that's your passion, he might be leading you into it. When I was studying in Bristol and Oxford during the 1980s, there was a couple, and they are here right now, Dr. Albert and Dr. Hiroko, the two of them are here. You understand? They're visiting Singapore. Thanks. Thank you. Please be seated. And they open their homes to Malaysian and Singapore students. And so every week we'll go over there and have makan. Everybody will bring something. Of course, woe be tight when we all think pakat, who is going to bring what? Everybody brings chicken. So you have varieties of Malaysian and Singapore chicken and don't know what kind of chicken there is. But it's a time where we have Bible study, it's a time where we share with each other, and a lot of lives were touched. So basically, if you've got a passion for something, it could be that the Lord might be calling you to open your life, to serve Him in that particular area. They did in terms of caring for students, their passion was students, and that's what they did. Or you might have passion for the underdogs. For me, it would be for the underdogs. Somebody joked with me, you know, I don't worry about the, you know, your direction in life. The Lord knows what it is. It's usually for dogs and underdogs, which is true. Migrant workers, prisoners, homeless, animals. But for some of you, it might be children. It might be trafficked children or people who are falsely accused. If you have a passion, that's an indication where the Lord might be leading you in terms of moving out of the box in an adventurous way. It might be also life experiences or failures or pain, because these are things that actually shape our emotions in a way. Some people, because they've gone through difficult times, they've got this deep compassion that some of us might not have for specific groups of people. During World War II, there was a young American soldier who was a prisoner of war, and he was put in one of these cattle trains and brought into Germany. And through that experience, he saw the suffering of people and he felt it very deeply. When he came to Singapore as a missionary, he started the Samaritans of Singapore, and he started the Church's Counseling Center, which is now called Counseling and Care Center. And that's Reverend Dr. Gunnar Tellman, who has since died. He's a Methodist pastor. You see, the Lord will use that which He's already implanted in us, your passion, your life experiences, to push us out of the box. Some of us are peeping out of the box at the moment and not very sure, you know. We must be willing to move. Some of us will just peep, look, go back to the box. We must be willing to move. The last song that we will sing today is, "Here am I, Lord. Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I've heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart." If there's this stirrings within, maybe it's about time we heard the words of William Carey. He said, "Expect great things from God, attempt great things for God." We always hold on to the first, expect great things from God. Yeah, I want prosperity, I want this and that. But he says, attempt great things for God. And he should know. He was a cobbler, but he had a gift of languages. So he went to India and he opened a university in India. He's known as the father of modern missions. He started an agricultural society of India. Maybe Michael Koh is into, you know, plants and stuff like that, might want to consider doing something in East Timor, maybe, you know, hint, hint. He was a social activist, and he partly stopped the widow, they used to burn the widows with their dead husbands in India as well. When the Holy Spirit comes, we must be willing to move. But the bottom line is a surrendered heart, a willingness, a daring, willing spirit to dare to move beyond the comfort zones, but also to serve where you are planted along the way as well. In 1904, there was a young man, 16-year-old guy. I think I just overhit the slide. Let me see if I can get the previous slide. If not, never mind. But his name was William Borden, and he was 16 years old only, and he finished secondary school, high school they call it, and his family very rich, you know. What they did was to celebrate his graduation, they gave him a ticket around the whole world. So he got to go around the whole world and enjoy himself. But when he went, he decided that the Lord was actually calling him to be a missionary. So he wrote at the back of his Bible, "No reserves," meaning that he's going to commit himself to serve the Lord wherever the Lord sent him. And so he went to Yale University. And he started, he did what John Wesley did, really. You know, he started prayer groups. And of the 1,300 students, 1,000 of them attended his prayer meetings. He cared for the widows, the drunks, the orphans, and so on, while he was in university, and touched many lives. Well, he graduated, and a lot of people wanted him to come and work for them, because, you know, this guy is obviously brilliant, an organizer, and so on. He turned down high-paying jobs. He went to study at Princeton Seminary to prepare himself. And he wrote in his Bible, "No retreats." He's not going to change his mind about serving the Lord. When he graduated from seminary, he wanted to reach out to the Muslim people in China, the Gansu people. And he went to Egypt to study Arabic because he needed that language. And when he was in Egypt, he died at the age of 25. We look at this, and this is his grave in Egypt. We say, "Ayah, Wasted, man. But then if you look at his Bible, there were another two words. He wrote at first, no reserves, no retreat. And then they found two words there. No regrets. What we see is someone who is adventurous for God, but whose life is surrendered. It's not that I must go to the Gansu people, so I'm preparing myself, so wait until I'm there, then I put 100% there. But it's that wherever I am in the university, I will serve, I'll leave the ultimate result to him. No regrets. You see, this is something that sometimes we target, okay, wait until I'm there, wait till I'm somewhere else where I think the Lord's calling me, then I will serve. But he served where he was planted. And a lot of people were inspired by his life. And because of who he was, there were more missionaries coming out to serve the Lord because of his life. The bottom line is a surrendered heart. A surrendered heart that dares to move forward. When you go home, do look at the bulletin, the notes, sermon notes there, because there are some questions for you to think about, some things for you to pray about. The Lord is calling us to be adventurous for him. He's pushing us, and some of you have felt the push to move out. It's one step at a time. Ordinary people like you and I can be called. God will use that which is inbuilt in us already to show us the direction in which he wants us to go out of the box. But we must be willing to move. And the bottom line is a surrendered heart. Are you willing to be adventurous for God? Let us pray. Lord, you have called us to be your people. You've asked us to move beyond that which we are comfortable with, to be everything you want us to be for the kingdom. So, Lord, would you just open our hearts and our minds to be willing to be challenged by you to move outside the box. And when you say, who will go for us? We say, yes, I will go. In the name of Christ, amen.